Hey, everyone. I'm Ryan.
And I am... Why do I Craig Mays in this thing every week?
Like every single dummy. Week you every... do that, bro.
God. Oh. What?
Studio's calling already. I'm going to take that, I guess. Hello?
Who are you talking to?
Oh, it's a studio. They're saying with Music Bed, you get access to higher quality music than any other music resource.
Well, and that's cool, but I mean, how good can the music even be, Ryan? Like, it's probably just ukuleles and whistling, or like, whoa-uh-ohs, or like, you know, swagger blues rock.
No. Like, the studio is saying that you get the real stuff you would listen to in real life, so they have all that, but so much more.
Uh-huh. Really?
Okay, yeah, they say there's great musicians, bands, composers. They pour their heart into the work. It's incredible.
Well, I mean, great, but like, I don't have $1 million to spend on music, so maybe I should just stick with, you know, one of the other companies. Well, they've got to have something there.
No. The studio, they're saying MusicBed subscription allows you to have unlimited access to their amazing roster of artists for one monthly or yearly fee. This is incredible.
They're saying all of that? They're saying every bit of that?
They said every single bit of this, and it's based on kind of work you do. That's right. Yeah, no. Okay. Yeah, the studio is saying if you're making personal shorts or web-based ads, your fee's going to be way less than if you're making a Super Bowl spot. Do you make Super Bowl spots, Seth?
I mean, I make them, but no, the Super Bowl never plays them.
Well, even if you're making those Super Bowl spots, MusicBed's pricing and library are an absurdly great sight to behold. At least that's what the studio said on the call.
Come to think of it, I use MusicBed regularly. I have no idea why I've been asking you all these questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Seth, now the studio's saying if I use coupon code GAMESHOW at checkout, I can receive my first month free when I purchase an annual subscription and start unlocking my film's full potential. Wow.
That's a lot. They said a lot to you in a very short amount of time.
No, I'll definitely use MusicBed. Yeah, MusicBed, MusicBed.com, is that one word?
One word, MusicBed.
Okay.
M, MusicBed.
Will do, yeah.
Ryan, we both use it.
Come on, code game show. Okay, thank you.
All right.
That was the studio. And there's multiple characters that, like, the night is ending and they look to the horizon and they're saying, here comes the sun.
Ah, perfect. Yeah, okay, excellent. I was waiting for that. Yep, now exactly. I'm in.
Now that locked him in. Perfect.
Hey, everybody, I'm Ryan.
And I'm Seth.
And welcome back to the Writers Room Game Show. It's the podcast where every week we generate an original feature film idea from scratch in under 60 minutes, working from a set of random prompts given to us by a big Hollywood studio.
At the beginning of every episode, the studio, which is really just an iPhone shortcut, assigns us, the contestants, a new project consisting of four components: the genre, the tone, the demographic, and a studio mandate. What's a studio mandate, Worley? Well, it's basically just a random thing the studio is requiring. What's a genre? You should know that. You're a writer. What's the tone? You're an idiot. What's the demographic? Well, that's an understandable question. It's the target audience of which we're going for.
I don't think you're an idiot audience. We then have one more. Just Seth.
He's shaking his head. You can't see him. Oh, we do video now.
Uh-oh. We then have 1 hour to develop a feature film idea that fits the assigned criteria with the surprise roadblock along the way.
What will it be? At the end of the episode, we'll focus group the idea with someone from the target audience which we were assigned, and we'll ask them four very important questions. Those four questions, tune in to find out at the end of the episode.
I love it. You're creating a curiosity for them to stick around.
Thank you. I'm harvesting an intrigue.
Yes, intrigue. And if they answer negatively, that's why, of course, we'll quit screenwriting altogether and then do it again next week, which is our finale next week.
We have a hotline. Call Christmas. It a notes hotline. Call the WRGS hotline. Hey, 1-866. Hey, WRGS. Call it. You have ideas. You have thoughts on all of our story ideas. So call it and give us your notes.
We actually,
what else, Ryan?
I was going to say, we actually had a few calls.
Excellent. Yes.
Yes. So we can visit some of those notes hotline calls that we got. We got two this week from actually frequent listeners. I think we've heard a few of these guys on our way back in our notes hotline episode. I say way back. It was a few months ago, but it feels like forever since this is an entire...
Is it L.A. Nick? Tell me it's L.A. Nick.
Yes. L.A. Nick called back.
L.A. Nick!
L.A. Nick! Left us a note on our episode featuring Mr. Ryan Booth, called Soft Air. I'm just going to go ahead and play it, and then we can talk about it right after.
Well, hey, guys. It's Nick from L.A. I know Seth is like, oh, L.A. Nick.
L.A.
In
Nick.
A bad way. No, I don't know how I got so far behind, but I finally caught up on your last four or five episodes because I was busy this summer. Nick. I just wanted to leave a constructive criticism note on the latest episode as I'm leaving this, which was soft air, air soft or air hard, or I don't know where you guys landed on that one. You guys started touching upon the veterans with PTSD trying to unload, you know, aggression into airsoft. I kind of cringe a little bit because I'm actually in the Navy. I'm a Navy veteran and I still serve in the Navy Reserve. And the people that I know that have PTSD, there's no way that reliving any of those kind of experiences would be therapeutic in any way whatsoever. In fact, I think PTSD is a very touchy subject that you shouldn't really, you know, try to grasp a hold of it and construct any kind of narrative around it unless you kind of have lived in that world or know people that have. I'm not myself a combat veteran, but I do know a lot of people that suffer from combat, specifically PTSD. And I mean, I know that you guys are pitching a movie in under an hour, and I know that it seemed like a good idea. I just wanted to give that note, not in any kind of shameful way or anything, because I really respect you guys and what you do, and I like your stories a lot. Obviously, I'm a fan of the podcast, but yeah, I just, that was a little cringy to me, and I'm sure any other veterans that were listening. So yeah, take that with a grain of salt. I mean, I'm not anybody that's in any kind of power to, you know, green light your projects or anything like that, obviously. But yeah.
That'd be a huge twist if he was.
Keep up the good work. I'll call in if I have any other notes, or I'm on your Discord now. Thank you for inviting me to that. And so I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot from each other. All right. See you guys. Bye.
Man, Nick.
That was a really great note. Ellie Nick.
That is, God, hey. That's why we made this Notes Hotline. That's exactly the kind of stuff we want. We want to hear from other people's perspectives that are not our own. We want to hear how, what we got wrong. I was expecting something like this after our
Salt and
the
pepper.
Premiere of this one.
The atrium when we had
the atrium, because we had a lot of characters with disabilities in that, and I don't know if you know, but neither you nor I technically have any physical disabilities that I know of.
And it's one of those things where, you know, we just kind of shout out ideas. We have 50 minutes. We have no research. There's probably some things that, you know, if we, in hindsight, that it's like, yeah, maybe we shouldn't put that in our script because we don't know from that perspective. And obviously that is a big one. And I think that's a really great note.
And what I love is that I love that LA Nick, seriously, LA Nick, I'll just call you Nick. Nick, we're friends now. I genuinely appreciate that you reaching out with this note and giving us this feedback, because, you know, as everyone knows, like normally, in an ideal world, if we're developing, just let's say we're developing even just a pitch, we still would hopefully have time to do sufficient research if we have any, even remotely an idea of like possibly tackling a subject matter of which we don't have any experience.
Yeah, we would consult an expert in that field too.
Yeah.
Someone who's lived through it.
Experts, collaborators, exactly. And of course, you don't have time in 60 minutes to do that. And so you know, we try to be as respectful as we can to other perspectives, like in subject matter where we would obviously ideally, I mean, we try to say it out loud on the show, like we would ideally prefer to have someone else creatively tackle the material that we're pitching. You did say salt and pepper, and that is true. Like that's one where it's about,
it's about two black female.
Three black women. Yeah, two black. Like female characters coming up in a world that we know nothing about. And it was so obviously you would want a black female voice behind that story.
Yeah.
Anyway, Nick.
That's it. Yeah, really great note. Ellie Nick, now known as Nick.
the artist formerly known as Ellie Nick.
Navy Nick. We love you. And yes, thank you for promoting the Discord, which you can find in the show notes. Join other listeners and talk about the show and other things. It's so fun. We have one more call I'll get to before, looks like we got some time before the studio calls, so I'm gonna play this one. I have no idea what this one is. Let's hear it.
Hey guys, it's Dan again. I have thoughts on Boots, your race car movie.
Boots.
You were looking for a way to get our character back into the Formula One world, it mixed with his, you know, getaway driver stuff. The offer that is presented to him can be from somebody on an opposing racing team asking him to steal race car or engineering secrets from the team that fired him.
That's great.
The espionage of racing is actually a really big kind of scandal thing that happens a lot and is a big deal.
I like that. Of course,
so the offer is basically that if you go steal the, you know, engine diagram for the new engine for the team that fired you, We'll hire you back to our team this next season so you can be our driver again because we really want your help. But it turns out, obviously, that that's not going to be a thing that's going to happen. They're just setting him up to be a disgruntled racer that is trying to screw over his old team, and they're going to let him take the fall for it. But in the process of stealing these plans, he has to sort of befriend and screw over his old racing teammate, who is kind of a younger sort of protege friend of his, and that can be sort of the motivation for the character development, where he realizes, you know, he should probably let go of this racing thing if it means that he has to screw over his old friend on his racing team that, you know, he actually kind of likes, and he's doing all these bad things where he should just, you know, chill out and stop cranking so much. Anyway, love the show. Love you both, as always. Goodbye.
Love you, Dan.
Dan Stern, that was an incredible note. I love it all. It's in the movie.
It's in the movie. Rent it now on iTunes. You'll see it.
I love the fact he's like, yeah, espionage is a big thing in the racing world. I'm like, well, no, that
he's deep in the racing world.
We have not researched the racing world, so it's good to know.
Today we're going to get assigned the most like foreign idea to us. Like,
it's like pick an industry that you know nothing about and make a movie about it. That's the mandate.
Speaking of
the mandate,
speaking of industry like we know nothing about,
let's check it out. Hello, studio.
Hello, Ryan. It's me, the studio.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, we have a great assignment for you. Sending it along to you now via electronic mail.
Okay. Yeah, no, that's fine. Okay, thank you. Bye.
You're welcome. Bye.
They said that they emailed me the assignment, so I'm going to go look that up.
I made them mad last time.
Let's see. Oh, interesting. This is fun. So we got a genre we haven't gotten before. Kind of broad. Thriller is our genre.
We've never gotten thriller before?
We've never gotten thriller as a genre, or we would have retired it. Cyber thriller is the closest thing we've gotten.
Okay.
The tone is witty. The demographic is fans of the Beatles. Kind of.
Hey, get back.
Kind of timely for our Disney Plus show. And the mandate is a note from the executive's assistant. The exec refuses to work with anyone who uses the word no. So please refrain from using the word no in the pitch.
This is okay. I put this one in there because this is a real story I heard about once A-list celebrity.
Let's in 1 second. Let's hear that story.
The writers. Game show has begun.
Okay, let's hear it, Seth.
Oh, that's it. Just that that's there's a real actor out there that I'll tell you off mic that I heard the story that they work under. I'll say it on mic. I heard it was John Travolta. I heard John Travolta has that rule with people that he works with. I don't know John Travolta. Well, that's Seth, the point of this episode.
I don't know if this...
Does Seth know John Travolta? The answer's no. Sorry.
I don't know if this is against the rules. That's a great mandate. I kind of want another mandate. Like, I kind of want another rule that we can use to kind of come up with our story, since we're so broad right now at the start.
Well, we're going to have to lose the John Travolta story.
No, I mean, like, add a mandate on top of our current mandate.
On top of it?
Yes.
You want to ask the studio for some extra direction?
Yes.
I guess we can do it. Why call not, the studio. Right?
Okay, let me call the studio. Let's...
Hello? No one's dialed the phone.
Hello, studio. Yes, we would like...
Oh, yeah, Ryan.
We were wondering if you had any other creative direction that we could use to... this. I know, it's out of the ordinary. Okay,
thank you. Be happy to. Email them to you now.
Thank you so much. Okay,
see? Bye. I'm also a gangster.
Okay, I'm looking up the email from the studio. Oh, it looks like they need a period piece set in the Old West.
What?
So a witty...
For fans of the Beatles.
A witty thriller for fans of the Beatles set in the Old West, and we're not allowed to say no in the pitch process. So pretty interesting movie we'll be writing here. Where should we start? I mean, Old West, it's nice we have a setting at least, right?
Fans of the Beatles... I'm going to immediately say, let's just try to...
Should we title it a Beatles song like we did?
Yeah,
with
I think that helps us.
I think that would be fun because we, of course, last season we had our Murder Most Foul co-written by Oscar-winning director Josh Cooley. I got to use the Oscar-winning
part.
Yeah, of course.
It's required.
Yes, it's required. But of course, that was quote-unquote inspired by a Bob Dylan song, which really we just used to...
that Bob Dylan song. Turns out it sucks.
It's terrible.
It's like 4 days long, and it's about the Kennedy assassination, and it came out like 2 years ago, so it's super topical.
Yeah, so I know both of us watched Get Back. Incredible documentary.
Loved Get Back.
It was 6 hours long. I could go 60 more hours.
Same here.
It shouldn't work, but it absolutely does.
Yeah, it's exactly the kind of doc that I want about every all of my favorite filmmakers and all my favorite bands. Like, totally. I just want footage of them. And you know, there are, I think on the E.T. and Raiders Blu-rays, there's really great. I remember there being really great mini docs of like, it's just the B-roll from set of Spielberg working with the kids or directing. Like, there's no narration, no interviews. It's just raw stuff. So if you like to get back and you're a film buff, check those out. You know, I talked about this on Instagram this past week. I asked the question, like, what's Beatles everyone's songs. Favorite Beatles song?
What is your favorite? I know you gave me a few. I can tell you mine.
My favorite is kind of a random one, but Back in the USSR is my favorite because I love that it's like McCartney trolling patriot rock at the time with a fake Beach Boys song and this like Suffragette City like Runaway Train riff going through. Mm-hmm. Like it's like my kind of pace of song, and it's really funny when you know the context of like you know when the song was written and why it was written. Mm-hmm. And I just recently learned that's when Ringo temporarily quit. So it's all three of them. It's a patches of all three of them playing drums on that track.
That's so funny.
But that's my favorite is Back in the USSR.
I like that. I love Hard Day's Night is one of my favorite movies.
Me too. No one understands how funny the Beatles are. It's like, so funny. That movie is so good.
Paul's grandpa. I'm like, that's freaking funny.
He's very clean. Yeah, very clean.
Very clean. But no, I love like early Beatles. I'm not a huge fan of post-drugs Beatles. I like
it. I wasn't for a long time until Get Back, honestly.
I've listened to Let It Be a lot more after that. But I think I Want to Hold Your Hand is probably my favorite. Just the really simple pop Beatles. I also like I'm Happy Just to Dance With You, just from that movie. I'm
happy just to dance with you, Polly.
Thanks, Seth. You too.
You're welcome.
But there's so, I mean, the Beatles, it's such a large catalog of songs. It's like, do you want to just go through it and whatever elicits sort of a Western idea?
Sergeant Pepper? Is that what we're going with? No.
Because
I'm just writing them down. Here Comes the Sun.
Here Comes the Sun. That I'm like, that's a kind of, it looks Western to me in my head. If it's like a thriller, something's happening.
Ticket to Ride.
Like, something's happening overnight and the sun, like by sunrise, they need to do something. So it's Here Comes the Sun, but it's very menacing.
Another cool one is Blackbird.
That's true.
Because Here Comes the Sun, kind of like, I like the idea of picking one that doesn't feel like this is a Beatles song. You know?
Too iconic. Blackbird.
Blackbird sounds cool. It's like, sounds almost like a spy movie.
We do a Western spy movie, like an Old West spy
movie. Yeah, what would that be? I don't even know.
What
they're like, no government. Like, so.
It's literally the Wild West. I don't know what. Yeah. I mean, we can start with Blackbird and just do something around that. And
yeah.
The witty element is interesting to me, too. A witty thriller in the Old West. Would we make it very, because witty to me is very much in the dialogue and the way the characters interact. Tone, too, is something that I'm like, I struggle with in terms of.
That's an execution.
Like story. Yeah, that doesn't, I was going to say, that's like in dialogue and the way the characters interact more than like story. And
there's nothing worse than giving a pitch where like, and this whole time we're getting that witty rat-a-tat dialogue of like an Aaron Sorkin
an Aaron Sorkin directed Western thriller for the fans of the Beatles.
That actually sounds unbelievably cool. I would watch that immediately. Starring Lucille Ball. Not someone playing Lucille Ball. Starring the OG Lucille Ball.
Okay, Western. For some reason, I know it's very much me and you. Well, when I think of like my first Western that comes to my mind is Back to the Future Part 3, which is like,
oh my God.
Which is not like
the first Western that comes to your mind.
Which is not like a true Western, but.
I mean, no, it's not.
It's not.
Silverado's great. 310 to Yuma's great. The Searchers is great. Like, there's so many, man. Like, what's the one the Coens remade that was like The Mandalorian but with cowboys? which The Mandalorian is a Western in space.
Wait, what?
With Jeff Bridges. The
True Grit.
True Grit.
Mandalorian.
I'm just realizing the girl in True Grit.
Yes, Hailee Steinfeld. She's
holy
great.
Crap.
That was her first never like, connected big break, for me. Yeah.
Wow, that's cool.
She's like having an incredible year because she has Hawkeye. She's the lead in
finishing
Arcane,
up Emily Dickinson,
and then Dickinson, and it's all like in the span of like 3 months. It's crazy.
And she's Spider Gwen, right? We've already talked about
this
on the podcast.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyways, yeah, man, this is tough. Blackbird.
What's Blackbird about?
I'm pretty sure
it's about taking broken wings and learning to fly. Obviously.
What if it's, well, yeah, what if our character, it's like a, you know, now I'm just like a Luke Skywalker type that's like longing to see the world and break out of their little Western town and see more of, I'm trying to think of what the thriller element of that would be.
Well, I'll take these broken wings and learn to fly. Like, that's like, see what you're describing, like the Luke Skywalker, like, I'm young, I want to be in the adventure, like, you know, hero. But like, take these broken wings and learn to fly. Like, that's Western. Like, that's super like, I've got nothing left to give and I am being asked to give everything I've got. And this is probably my last ride. And here we go. Like,
so like a Solo in the jungle, really rusty.
Just like Mario Van Peebles is Solo in the jungle.
In the hit movie, Disney's John Disney's Carpenter's. The computer word Jordan's. No, yeah, totally. I mean, I feel like that can inspire an interesting Western.
You know that the trailer is the song, but like...
But dark and moody.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
It's like if Johnny Cash were alive, you get Johnny Cash to record it.
A minor version. Of Blackbird?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then like at the end it's like, Blackbird, fly.
This feels very generic though. It's like a Western called Blackbird.
Yeah, this is tough. It's still very broad.
Okay, hey, you know what? You did this at the beginning of the show. Why can't we just do it? Why can't we roll for another mandate again? What? Like, what if we had a card game? What if we were going, like, what if, you know, we had something where we were going to, like, what if there were something that could be, you know, like the Writer Emergency Pack or like something where...
Yeah, that would be great.
That was
to have
made
like
as a game. Like a It'd be great to have something. Be great to have something that was like a deck of cards, like a big deck of cards that was made for like for fun and games, like game night. But also, you know, you could use it in a writer's room, or you could use it, you know, by yourself.
Yeah,
to
that'd
like
be really nice.
Trigger ideas.
If there's something like that, I would use it all the time. You know, just
I'd
look
use
at
it all the time.
Look at all these, just you know, like studio mandates on cards. Something like that.
Yeah. Maybe in the new year. Maybe something yeah. like that will come up at the, toward the beginning of next
maybe
year.
Maybe sometime in the next few months. I don't know.
But anyway, that'd be really cool. on another note, back to the show. Why don't we roll another mandate? Why don't we actually ask the studio for another mandate just to say yeah. like, hey, look, we really want to know look, how can we best serve you know your like goals?
I think that's know, a great idea. I'll ask them to email you, Seth. Here, let me.
Okay.
It's a very long phone number. Okay. Hey, studio, it's Ryan again. Mm-hmm. I know. No, we just, we really love your input. You know, we really want to make this something that you guys love. Okay, yeah.
Is there anything they're looking for? Ask them if there's anything they're looking for to, like, fill their slate.
Yeah, did you hear Seth? Okay, yeah. No, you're on speakerphone, actually. Oh, we can't hear you. Sorry. Goodbye. Okay.
They really want some, okay, so I got it. They're looking for a G rating. Looking for movies, G rated films, okay. Films for family films for kids.
G rated films, family films for kids.
So.
Something they can play at elementary school.
What if it's an animated film? Because right now there aren't a lot of G rated live action movies. It's not the 90s anymore.
I miss the 90s.
I miss them too. Although,
animated film, that could be fun.
An animated film about a real blackbird.
Smart. I like it. Voiced. By Paul McCartney.
No, I don't think so.
No, I do think Paul and Ringo make voice cameos as characters in the movie.
For some reason, that sounds like a bad idea to me, and I don't know why.
A cameo? You don't like the idea of this?
Cameo? Yeah. Cameos. If it's the way that Cooley did it in Toy Story 4, where like you didn't even realize like he had Carl Reiner and Don, like,
I'm thinking Mel just Brooks. Cameos. If you're a Beatles fan, like you'd get it because, you know, the character's like, peace and love. You're like, that's Ringo.
that is only Ringo.
No, but yeah, very small. Anyways, but yeah, I like where this is going. We can have a Western literally about a blackbird. And we
now we're still like, what's the story? So let's learn about blackbirds.
What's interesting that think of like Rango, a movie I love, yeah. Which is not rated G, I would add. It's a very dark animated movie.
I've never seen it. I've
never seen Rango.
Very dark. No.
Oh, it's really good. I you would like Rango a lot. Have your kids
really?
Seen it?
No, but now you say it's really dark.
Well, I say like, really dark. I mean, for like very small, it's like an animated movie. You'd think like, oh yeah, I could take, you know, my 5-year-old. It's like, it's probably a little dark for a 5-year-old, but you know, like a probably 8 or 9-year-old would love it.
Okay.
But it's one thing I like about that is it's like a very traditional Western, but all the characters are animals and they sort of, the way the animals move and communicate and like, you sort of have this really unique characterization of all these animals. And of course, there's a huge snake that's, you know, terrorizing a town, just like it would be like a old, you know.
It's like it sounds like a Bug's Life, but with.
Yes, it's very similar to Bug's Life, yeah.
So the Wikipedia page for a common blackbird, by the way, the very first sentence, mm-hmm. I know nothing about birds. I'm going to preface I know nothing about birds. The common blackbird is a species of true thrush. Polly, what is that sense?
True thrush?
Which I'm gonna argue that's the name of our film, True Thrush. I've never heard of a Western film more Western than that.
Seth, I'm not gonna lie to you, I hate that word.
I know. True thrushes are medium-sized, mostly insectivorous or omnivorous birds in the genus Turdus of the wider thrush family Turdidae. Turdus is Latin for thrush. We're getting nowhere with this. The term thrush is used for many birds of the family, as well as for a number of species belonging to several other families. Bird scientists, please write in. 1-866-HEY-WRGS. I was looking for something thematic about blackbirds.
Can I say something? I don't want to throw us off. I looked up the meaning of Blackbird, the Beatles song, as written by Paul McCartney. So it says, in 2018, McCartney further elaborated on the song's meaning, explained that Blackbird should be interpreted as black girl in the context of the civil rights troubles in southern 1960s U.S.
Whoa.
And he said, so I'm assuming, you know, bird as, you know, in the U.K. is what they often called girls. So I guess this was
what
so you don't know that
really.
Yeah,
you never. He's singing black girl.
He's singing about a black girl during the civil rights movement, and I think it's like a sort of a social commentary song.
Wow. Okay. Remember when I said we were going to write about from a perspective that we are unqualified to write for.
Well, I think, yeah, it's I just wanted to make sure, like, we knew the meaning of those lyrics before we kept moving on, which I don't think is, like, we can just have it inspired by the title and still, but it's clear to me now that this is more about a black girl, and when it's saying waiting for the moment to be free, they're talking about, you know,
oh, damn,
the civil rights movement.
Well, that's amazing.
Which is great.
It's great. We are fully unqualified to write that.
And good news is we have 23 minutes to work on the rest of our movie.
Oh man,
this is a Western. You know, we can play some Western movie tropes. I still I feel like we can continue with Blackbird and just be inspired by the title. I think that would be totally fine because fans.
So you want to just kind of like not disregard, but just say we know that's what the song is about. We are.
I don't know, because when I think of like target audience, fans of the Beatles, it's like, okay, what are the Beatles fans like? The Beatles?
Good music. The Beatles.
So like, it's kind of a broad thing, because it's like, I know Beatles fans that are super into horror movies and Beatles fans that are only watch, you know, animated kids films. It's like, it's a very broad thing. So it's just like, what part of that
Beatles? Well, it's true. And when you asked me, oh, this is hard, because when you asked me, when we were talking about our favorite Beatles songs, you didn't ask me, I asked you. I told you mine were like, you know, back in the USSR, mm-hmm. Lady Madonna, Paperback Writer, Dear Prudence. You were like, you know, you're like, mine are none of those. Like, mine are all these other songs. And it's like, it shows one, how amazing the Beatles were and the vast, like the range of the Beatles, mm-hmm. but also just like how they're so universal and that people, like everybody's set of favorite Beatles songs are completely different than the next. Mm-hmm. So we're like fans of the Beatles. Well, that's just human. That's just smart human beings who we're writing the movie for.
But I still think
it's not a niche. That's not a niche audience. Yes. You know, we're not writing for.
That's why we struggle. We always struggle the most with the broadest ideas, the broadest assignments. So we've got a witty, a rated G Western for fans of the Beatles. Well, I guess the Western's not it's a thriller. It's just set in the Old West.
Oh, yeah.
So
rated G, a G-rated thriller.
Oh, that's interesting.
Okay. No, that is more specific. You're right.
Maybe we, because it's set in the Old West. So I mean, we could do it sort of a fun. There's some movies that it's like clearly a modern sort of feel, but it's set in I'm thinking of like a Sherlock Holmes with Robert Downey Jr., where it's like, to me, that's clearly like a very modern film, but they're like, this is placed in the, like, whenever Sherlock Holmes is placed, like, I couldn't tell you what the 1800s or something, or early 1900s, but the technology was very modern. They sort of modernized it. If we were to do sort of an Old West, like a blend of, I don't know. I don't know where I'm going with this. Because rated G, I'm like, yeah, it's probably an animated movie. It's probably about happy animals. And yeah, this is tough. This is tough, Seth.
We could just remake the show The Wild Wild West, which was made with Will Smith and Selma Hayek and Kevin Klein.
the Wild Wild West, but a rated G animated film for fans of the Beatles?
Look, the Addams Family, there's two animated Addams Family movies. Honestly, it wouldn't be a bad... play.
Let's do that. We have 20 minutes left. Let's just say,
okay,
let's remake an animated version of Wild Wild West. Why not? You know, I feel like we can use that time well and make it fit. So I guess that it's sort of a thriller. Wild Wild West, it's sort of a action. There's a lot of mystery in it, right? I'm trying to remember the plot of Wild Wild West. Very steampunk. Spider crawling around in the third act.
Well, it's the source of our the Wes Anderson idea we wrote. Yeah. We had that mandate, put the spider in the third act. Yes. And we talked about it on the show. Like, when Kevin, did we talk about it on the show? And Kevin Smith was writing Superman. Yeah.
And he said, no, I'm not doing that. And then they ended up putting it in a different movie. And
this producer, same producer, ended up putting it. Yeah.
Which is really funny that a producer's like, I will get my giant spider, whether you like it or not. So I'm gonna read the plot of this movie. We're just gonna, you know, we got
the movie. You're not looking at the TV show.
Oh, the TV show.
It's based on a TV show. That's why I'm saying it's like the Addams Family is a good comp because it's based on an old TV show.
I didn't even know it was a TV show.
Oh yeah, dude. Oh man, that's an even more random movie if you don't know that it's based on a TV show. Based on a TV show, a 1965 TV show starring Robert. Robert.
Huh? You said Salma Hayek, so I was just thinking about the movie.
Earlier. Oh, I mentioned the movie, but no, Robert okay. Conrad and Ross Martin were in the. So a white man when Smith was cast, it took on a very different connotation, having mm-hmm. a black man in mm-hmm. the Old West. And I think they addressed it, but they I don't know if they addressed it in a. Yeah, they addressed it.
Which he was originally going to be cast as Django as well, which
yes, which
sort
awesome.
Of reminds me of that. And then he said no because of all the race stuff. And I think Will Smith likes to have
I think what I heard, the reason he said no to Django was because Django doesn't, was it Christoph Waltz kills a bad guy? Was it Christoph Waltz like actually finishes the job at the end? Gotcha. Like he's like.
Interesting.
Which I think is heard really, rumors really great.
Where, yeah. Oh, totally. I always heard rumors that he was just like, I want to, I play this kind of character. I want to keep playing this kind of character because it is a very different kind of character that you would expect.
It might
from
be
Will
that,
Smith.
But Will Smith. Think about it. Okay, let's start with the. We're supposed to be writing a movie, but that's okay. This is how real writers' rooms go. The brilliant thing about Will Smith and the period that we all really know, like. Mm-hmm. And love his like film work from of the 90s. Mm-hmm. Apparently, and I don't know if this is just, retconned and made up after the fact, but it doesn't matter. It's smart. And he and his manager went through, looked at like the top, highest grossing films of the time and decided mm-hmm. that each one, they're all rated PG-13. They all have a creature in it and they all come out like 4th of July weekend or something. And he's like, so those are the projects we're going to look for the next 5 years.
Amazing.
And it became like Big Willie Weekend, which is what I believe it was referred to. Of like,
no way.
Independence Day, Men in Black, like Wild Wild West, even though it was kind of a bomb, like was part of that too. Like he was the king of that, man.
The king. Will Smith. Well, this is different. So Wild Wild West told the story of two Secret Service agents, the fearless and handsome James West and Artemis Gordon, a brilliant gadgeteer and master of disguise. Okay, the movie took that same thing.
Worth noting, the Wikipedia page describes it as an American Western espionage and science fiction television series.
It's perfect. A thriller set in the Old West. Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Their mission was to protect President Ulysses S. Grant and the United States from all manner of dangerous threats. Okay, so was this like a serial kind of thing where it's like every episode they had a different threat? I would imagine that's how...
Yeah, it was like all shows back then were Monster of the Week shows. Like
agents traveled in luxury aboard their own train, The Wanderer. That's kind of fun. Equipped with everything from a stable car to a laboratory. James West had served as an intelligence and cavalry officer in the American Civil War on Grant's
Michael
staff.
Garrison, the creator, conceived it as James Bond on horseback. It's pretty great.
That's kind of fun. Yeah. I mean, that's a thriller, Western thriller. That's great. That's a spy movie. And here we were doubting that spy movies wouldn't work in the Old West.
Also, everyone listening, stop complaining about how there's only remakes and not original stories. Like, look how much we were suffering.
Imagine real writer's room. They're sitting around for weeks. We can't think of any original ideas. What if we just remade Wild Wild West?
Ryan, do you celebrate Cyber Monday?
I do celebrate Cyber Monday. Cyber Monday is one of my favorite holidays. We sit around, watch The Matrix and Johnny Mnemonic.
That's definitely how
cyber
definitely how it's intended to be celebrated is by spending your money every year. Hopefully you're renting it, so you're constantly spending new money on
new
Johnny
money.
Mnemonic.
Yep, exactly. And at a discounted price. At a discounted price.
Everyone knows that those two films are the things that go on sale. Now, here's the thing. Have you ever wondered... My God, why, God, why is Cyber Monday over? Have you ever wondered that?
I have. You know, it ends and you're like, why not Cyber Tuesday or Cyber Wednesday? Like, why can't we always have cyber?
Why can't we always be cybering? So we thought the same thing over at Plot Devices, me and my Plot Devices partners. We were like, you know what? We're bringing Cyber Monday back. They tried to end it yesterday, but by God, we said no, no.
Wait, so you're having Cyber Week? Is it Cyber
We're having Cyber December. We didn't just bring it back. We made it every damn day until Christmas. Did you know that now through Christmas, you can get 30% off all digital products at the Plot Devices makes using coupon code DIGI30? Yeah.
I can go to plotdevices.co and I can buy a digital version of the story clock work at 30% off.
That's right. Not only that, you can get the storyboard workbook digital edition. You can even get the story clock and storyboard pro kit, which is both of those workbooks digital edition for 30% off now through Christmas. All you got to do is use the coupon code DIGI30 at checkout. That's DIGI30, which was your nickname when you turned 30. As we all know, that entire year we were like, what's up, DIGI30? This code ends December 26th at 2 a.m., I'm pretty sure. Central, but the point is until now.
Cyber December.
Cyber December. Listen to Cyber Claws. He's a cat. If you go to our site, you can see. Plotdevices.co. Do it.
Coupon cyber. Code DG30. Cyber. Without the cyber.
So what's our take on it? G-rated, it's animated. Much the comp we'll give is Adam's Family.
I think we need to have sort of a fun original, like, because if we have our heroes, they're protecting the president. If we have like an original threat that is, you know, sort of antagonist, and we can sort of weave that, you know, original story with these characters and with they can have their fun, you know, sci-fi technology and the Wanderer train and that kind of thing. Or steampunk, listen, I guess it would be.
The most memorable recurring arch villain. I'm going to butcher the first name. I'm sorry, but Dr. Miguelito Quixote Lovelace. Dr. Lovelace.
Dr. Lovelace.
A brilliant but petulant and megalomaniacal dwarf portrayed by Michael Dunn. Initially, he had two companions, the huge Voltaire, played by Richard Kiel, and the beautiful Antoinette, played by Dunn's real-life singing partner, Phoebe Doran.
So should we have Dr. Lovelace as the villain?
100%.
Okay. He was in the...
Played by Paul McCartney? I agree.
Yes. He's the villain. Oh my gosh. He was the villain of Get Back too. I'm just kidding.
No, he was not. I know. How dare you? I'm a McCartney guy, man.
No. Yeah. Okay. So we have our cast of characters. Let's see. What's an interesting rated G sort of threat that Dr. Lovelace...
Huge spider.
We got to cut the huge spider. We did.
No.
We did.
If we're not doing it, we'll do like an homage. Like there'll be some kind of moment, you know,
like a shadow going over. It's like, is that a huge spider? And then it reveals that it's something else. It's a little spider crawling around on the ground. Yeah. What can we do? What if there's a big twist? Like a big. Sometimes you know these remakes and reboots. Think of like the J.J. Abrams like Star Trek, where it's like how you have what's his name, Benedict Cumberbatch. He's playing Khan, but what do they call him? It's like
They call him John Harrison.
John Harrison. Khan, yes.
Yeah.
We have something that it's like maybe Dr. Lovelace is originally like the third musketeer to our two guys, and it's sort of it's like an origin story of sort of how he became a villain and how they became like how they got on the Secret Service or something, like an original story that gets us to where they are in the original series or something.
Yeah, origin story. I like that.
Because that way we can sort of, tell an original story. The characters, apparently people know and love. I didn't know them. But kind of go that way, because then we at least have, we know what will happen to them at the end. So we can sort of...
It's a buddy movie about like Bond and Q, essentially, like coming up together. It's almost like Monsters University, like Sully and Mike. Like,
yes, I like that.
It's like you have the, you know, the Bond kind of character, the like...
What if there's like...
Cowboy and then the smart, like, you know, gadget guy, and the two of them being stuck together are having it's Kirk and Spock. That's exactly who it is. It's Kirk and Spock. We're talking about the first Star Trek.
Yeah, we just needed to talk. Yeah, dude, Star Trek, the final frontier. is the first frontier.
It's true. It is a thing.
It's a Western thing. That's why it's the frontier. Yeah. Whatever.
But like, that's the dynamics, the character dynamic you're going for. It's like Kirk and Spock having to work together for the first time.
What if it's, you know, instead of like a, you know, our Starfleet Academy or whatever, what if it's like at, I don't know if there's a training thing for the Secret Service, if there's some sort
We'll make it up if there's not. Yeah. Yeah, Secret Service,
some sort of, like, if it starts with them,
Secret
like
Secret Service School.
Graduating from university or something. I don't know if I don't know when this takes place in terms of the American history. I guess Civil War era.
Training for Secret Service agents often.
So right after the Civil War, there's like universities and stuff. So what if it had our two guys graduating university and going to
Secret Service University, SSU.
I guess I don't know how much kids for rated G are that interested in these people graduating from the prestigious Secret Service University.
By the way, every episode started with the night. The night of the man-eating house, the night of the casual killer.
Interesting. Okay, then that's got to be...
This is becoming more and more my kind of show.
The hard day's night, the night of the hard day, or something like that. there's Beatles right there.
So I was going to try and rope in a little more of Beatles dynamic for someone who's...
We just pitch it, and their relationship, instead of Kirk and Spock, we just say it's like John and Paul.
Paul and Lennon. You know, it's not really... Paul and John is not really that dynamic.
Paul and
it?
George.
Like,
we have a front...
The Beatles dynamic is so much more complex than I originally thought it was.
It really is, yes.
So like, by that, I mean like you can't really pin any one of them into an archetype, I don't feel like. I feel like they all...
It used to be like, it's like the quiet one, the artsy one. They're all sort of...
You had like the artist, the commercial one, the like... the quiet, like the bass player for the Ringo that thing you do, and the and the jokester, and you're like, oh, they're all really damn funny, and they're all really great writers and like contributing equally. And John Lennon was a lot funnier than I thought John Lennon was.
Yes, I'm wondering if that was the drugs he was on that entire time, but
possibly. I did like that shot where he pulls out a joint. Does he pull a joint out of his like pocket, looks at the camera, and then puts it back?
I don't remember that, but it's really funny.
Yeah, they went out of their way to highlight it. It was pretty funny. Don't do drugs, kids.
Don't do drugs. Cocaine.
Cocaine. Drugs are so bad.
Okay, so we have our James West and Artemis Gordon. James T. Kirk and Artemis Kirk, and I'm just kidding. So they become secrets.
I mean, really, it's about them in Secret Service, like school, like in training to be Secret Service. They don't get along. Mm-hmm. They're forced to work together, and
also at the school is
Dr. Loveless.
Yeah, Miguelito Loveless.
He's their teacher.
I think he's a classmate that I don't want to do the whole thing where it's like he's kind of a jerk and he's kind of like or like they pick on him and stuff and that turns him in like the old I don't like that. It's the when the Incredibles, what's his name, the villain, the Incredibles. But yeah, what if he's like a classmate and like he tries to assassinate the president or something after rated G2? It's like can we do like someone's trying to kill the president in a rated G?
No, they're just trying to like steal something or blow up something, like sabotage, and they're trying to sabotage a bridge or rob an old like bank or like
yes, with mechanical animals that he builds, because that's his whole thing.
That's his whole big thing. Actually, is funny if like that's his whole thing. And they're like, he really needs to get off that. Actually, I kind of love that, to be honest. If like that's
they start Dr. really Loveless's small and like you got to stop doing like that's not going to go anywhere. And then by the end, he's in a huge mechanical gorilla or something, like a Megazord.
He's in a Megazord.
A steampunk Megazord terrorizing the Old West town.
I think the steampunk thing was more of a...
Was that just the movie?
Yeah, that was the movie, okay, like the movie's interpretation of like that idea. Like, I'm not a big steampunk fan. I don't know
many people that are, Seth.
I know. I think there's a cooler route to doing like our spy, you know, Old West spy gadgets stuff.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, in 4 minutes, let's just come up with like a beginning, middle, end. So we have, obviously, the end, it has them becoming Secret Service agents, and it's like Ulysses S. Grant, like, hey, boys, and it's like, you know, they're assigned to their post at the end, basically where the TV show starts. So if we sort of start by seeing it through one of, like, Jane's perspective, maybe, like the Captain Kirk style, and it's him, do we want to go, like, he doesn't want to become a Secret Service agent, he wants to do something else, and then he gets wrapped up into it, and... Like if his dream is...
Sorry, yeah.
I was going to say if his dream is to be like a... I don't know what jobs there are in the Wild West. but like...
None. I think that was the whole thing.
go ahead.
The character dynamics, I'm thinking like, what if Art is Artemis?
Artie, we can call Art.
If Art and Loveless are actually best friends at the beginning.
Oh, that's good.
And so we can see that dynamic kind of break apart.
And Loveless is kind of one of those, like, he doesn't really treat Artie right. It's like sort of like Art doesn't have a lot of friends, but and Loveless takes advantage of him and all this stuff. And then eventually he meets James and they become good friends. And Loveless is sort of poisoned by jealousy, something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, that can work.
And eventually, maybe he tells Art, like, my plan is to rob the banker. I'm only doing this so that I can learn or like use the technology to blow up the bank and steal all the money or whatever. And he's like, I want no part in this.
What if they don't like James? James West? Is that really his name?
James West, yeah.
Yeah, he's the Wild Wild West.
Oh my gosh.
What if they're like trying to like get, like, what if he's kind of like a jock, kind of a, you know, character,
Art,
like
Ringo voices Art,
a Kirk kind of character, and they're all trying to like get back at him. No, they're trying to like like they're trying to work up some major prank to like embarrass him or do something to where like they don't like him, and they're trying to, and Dr. Loveless wants to take it too far, and Art is like, you know, no, that's gonna actually kill him, and or that's, you know, that's actually too far, yada yada, blah 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 blah. Ideas.
Yeah, I mean, that could totally work.
There's gotta be some sci-fi like some, you know, espionage sci-fi threat. That's the thing, is like the part about Dr. Loveless being a student, what's hard for me is like in Star Trek, Nero was this outside threat that like forced these like Starfleet's like students to like become you know, real Starfleet officers.
I think I think what the only thing that attracts me to that is them having a history and having like sort of a relational thing.
Well, that's like, but what if he's like a mentor? Like what if,
because that
if
way he's just has been a mentor access to the technology and the resources to build a big sci-fi weapon or whatever.
And that was Baymax, was the Big Hero 6 had that element of it too, where the mentor or teacher was actually turned out to be the bad guy.
That's true. Yeah.
I think that's kind of the dynamic we go for.
Yeah.
He's played by McCartney, right?
Yeah, Paul McCartney from Liverpool.
Okay. How much time we got?
We are out of time, Seth.
Okay.
Time to pitch your movie.
This might take the cake from Salt and Pepper. I think it's you know what? It was interesting. It was a challenge this week, but you know, we persevered. We tried to make something. Hopefully it was an entertaining listen, but we now have to take what we came up with and present it without saying no, I might add, and to our focus group. So here we go.
He has written music for everything from national ad campaigns to video games, apps, fashion events, Vimeo staff pick short films, A-list, corporate scoring work for brands like Netflix and Google, even a Super Bowl commercial for McDonald's. You may know him from the viral TikTok success of his song I Hear a Symphony, or his incredibly awesome cover, and this is why I called you here today, Cody, his incredibly awesome cover of Eleanor Rigby, which was recently nominated for a freaking Grammy. Please welcome Cody Fry to the Writers' Room Game Show.
That guy sounds cool.
He is very cool.
That guy's very done a lot cool. of stuff.
There's things I didn't even know about you that a Google search today revealed about you that we need to talk about later on.
Well, you know, when I'm meeting people, I don't just like begin by telling them everything that I've done. So it's kind of an awkward way to start a conversation. Let me tell you about all the achievements I've made.
Oh my God, I shouldn't be pulling my Dove Award out at the beginning of every conversation.
Dove Award winning filmmaker, Seth Worley.
they go together. They make sense and they're relevant.
Cody, thank you so much for being on the show. We have a
my pleasure
movie to pitch you. I was going to say a very fun movie. We'll see if we
pass the test. We love this. We own this idea and we love it.
Okay, yes. We have the best idea ever for you. Okay, I might have gone too far. But I'm going to tell you the assignment we were given today, and then we're going to start our pitch. So here we go. So the genre we were assigned today was a thriller. The tone is witty, and the demographic is for fans of the Beatles. And,
oh, you're a fan of the Beatles.
Yeah, I think Cody's, I would assume, based on the cover of Eleanor Rigby, Grammy nominated. And we got a few studio mandates, one of which was that it needed to be set in the Old West, and the other was that it needed to be rated G. And,
oh my God.
And not only needed to be rated G and set in the Old West, we had a third one that we are not allowed to use the word no in this pitch whatever reason, because ultimately the executive we're pitching to doesn't like to hear the word no. So we need you, if it's possible, I'll try to, but keep tabs on how many times we say no in this pitch.
All right.
And grade us on that, please. Yes.
I'll do my best. You guys must like, you know, self-inflicted pain, because that's one of the hardest pitches I've ever heard in my whole life.
We, you know what? This was one of the best episodes we've ever had. We got a lot.
No, please keep that context at the forefront of your mind while we pitch this to you.
But I'm happy to say, Cody, that the movie we'll be pitching you today is actually called Wild Wild West. And that might sound familiar to you because it is an animated remake of Wild Wild West.
The original television show from 1965, not the Will Smith, Kevin Klein, Barry Sonnenfeld film, which is also based on the show.
I was thinking Wicked Wild Wild. That's what I was thinking.
We're all thinking that at all times. And that's okay. We still should think about it, I think.
Yeah. I'm just going to start the pitch. Seth, please jump in.
Go for it. I'm going to keep track of the nose.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much. So our movie actually, as the title might let you know, it takes place in the Wild Wild West back in 1860s era, post-Civil War. And our movie centers around, keep in mind, this is animated. We've got a character named James West, who is...
The Wild Wild West.
Yes, the titular character, Wild Wild West. And he is actually enrolling in Secret Service School, which is
Secret Service University.
University,
right?
Yes. And he's sort of a loner, this James West, but he's, you know, he's excelling in Secret Service University. And a few of his classmates, actually, I think we changed this.
Is it really called Secret Service University?
Yes.
We don't know. We're just calling it that while we figure out what the real name is. But if we can get away with that, we're going for it.
Yeah, it's the SSU. But one of his classmates is a fellow named Artemis Gordon, who is sort of a brilliant gadgeteer. He's sort of a master of technologies, where James West is sort of he's more of your typical action star, where he's got a lot of one-liners.
I see.
And so there's a nice little, they play off each other, but they're not friends at the start, because Artemis is actually, his best friend is his professor, Dr. Lovelace, who is, he's sort of your nerdy guy who just likes hanging out at school and working on his whatever. And Dr. Lovelace is actually voiced by Paul McCartney.
Ooh.
The
I see. We have the entrance of our first Beatle.
Yes, I'm sure. Yes,
got to appeal to those Beatles fans, that niche audience that they are.
Right.
Yes, and I think Seth is going to jump in and continue this pitch.
Oh, he is. So, Polly, remind me, Dr. Lovelace. We landed on he a student or he is a mentor?
He's a professor. He's a mentor.
Mentor. That's right. So Artemis gets along really, really well with Dr. Lovelace. They are, you know. Artemis reminds Lovelace of like a younger version of himself. The two of them, though Lovelace is a professor, he can't really let on what he really thinks of some other students, but they both kind of see West as like this kind of lughead of like a, you know, a jock. He's like, if you imagine what James Bond probably was like in college, he was not too likable by the Q, you know, by the Qs of the world. Our idea is to basically the whole film takes place at Secret Service University. And what we want to do is by the end of the film, we want to get the characters to a place to where they are, where Dr. Lovelace has proven to be a bad guy. He and Artemis have a falling out. And when the two of them try to basically Lovelace manipulates, like the idea is that Lovelace like starts trying to help Artemis in a way that is to West's detriment. And Artemis ends up getting to a point of sticking up for West. And then like somehow we want to reveal that Lovelace is working on some major scheme that threatens the president and the world. And
yeah. And Lovelace has a thing where throughout the movie, he's been making these little gadgets, He likes making mechanical animals. And and by the end of the movie, he's built a huge, you know,
a classic hobby.
Yes.
Classic Western hobby. But we basically want to get to the film to a place where the series starts. Like, we want to get it to where Artemis and West are the team that we know them as. West and Artemis are basically like Bond and Q. Like, you know, the series was originally pitched as James Bond on horseback. And so that's what we want to get to. And so this movie is like, if you will, like JJ's Star Trek to the Wild Wild West, where you know, that movie was like the Starfleet Academy versions of Kirk and Spock. They don't like each other, and we force them to work together and find common ground and get them in the places that we know them as. That's like our goal with the film.
While still keeping very family friendly.
Yeah,
there's a lot of witty banter too. Like when you know, after a long day's work, Art is just like, I've got blisters on me fingers.
Impeccable. Okay. Excellent.
I love in a pitch when someone tells me that there's going to be witty banter, which is like, well,
we literally joked about that.
Just imagine funny things happening, and that's what the movie's going to be.
God, okay. Cody, I love you. I love you, man. I literally said that in the episode. Like, there's obviously this whole time we're hearing, you know, that Aaron Sorkin witty rat-a-tat-tat back and forth between...
Sorkin has dialogue. Love that.
So you're getting it. So Cody gets it. Cody gets what we're doing here. And, you know, I don't know if we mentioned this, but the reason we went animated was we thought, like, you know, there are now two Addams Family movies that are animated. There's a good market for that, of where, like, when we were kids, like, they were making a lot of these live action movies based on old shows. Like, we're now making animated films kind of based on old shows and kind of old movies, so that IP awareness is there. And so we just want to have fun with this IP and tell, like, a secret agent, you know, story, like an espionage thriller in the Wild West with a bunch of Beatles songs. And will you score it, Cody? The end.
Tell me more about how the Beatles songs get in. Well, here's this whole story.
I'd love to.
Here's the Wild Wild West original TV series. Actually, every episode was titled The Night of the Poisonous Posy was the pilot episode. So one of the subtitle in the beginning of the movie will just say The Night of the Hard Day.
I've heard of the hard day.
So we'll have lots of little sub chapter titles that are Beatles songs.
Okay. The night, but not too long, because for whence the sun is coming. Naturally.
Yes, exactly.
That's good. So we've got the titles, but still waiting for how the music fits into...
Well, actually, yes. And Ringo is actually scoring the film.
No, oh, Cody good. Is.
Yes, well, no, I mean, Cody, that's fine. Cody Fry is scoring the film.
Cody Fry is scoring
Ringo
the film.
We can partner on it.
Yes.
Perfect.
And there's multiple characters that, like, the night is ending and they look to the horizon and they're saying, here comes the sun.
Perfect. Yeah. Okay. Excellent. I was waiting for that. Yep, now exactly. I'm in.
Now that locked him in. Perfect.
Yeah, that's our movie, Wild Wild West.
Yeah, we literally have nothing else. So really what we want to ask you, Cody, are four very important questions, and Polly's going to ask them.
Yes, I am. And the first question, Cody, these are all rate 1 to 10. And the first question is, how likely are you to see this movie? 1 to 10. Maybe take some kids in your family, you know, go take the whole family.
Yeah, okay. So I need to preface this by saying I've seen two movies in the last 2 years.
special.
Me personally, probably a low likelihood. Also, lack of children, probably also lowering the likelihood. But if I knew you guys were involved, that brings me at least to like a 5. Like, I'm not out.
Not bad. Okay. We'll take it.
But yeah, I'm not like way in. I'd wait for the trailer, you know?
Oh, the trailer's good, man.
If the trailer really hooks me, then we're probably in business.
Yeah, did you tell him the music that'll be in the trailer?
Originally, not anymore. The trailer, before we got the G-rated mandate, the trailer was going to be a moodier updated version of Blackbird.
Like in a minor key.
Not anymore.
Yes.
Now it's just going to be Eleanor Rigby
music at the moment. Oh, yes.
Now it's just going to be your Grammy nominated.
That you can use.
Perfect. And then Lady Madonna, weirdly, halfway through, it's going to cut into.
Yeah. Excellent.
Second question. How likely are you to recommend this movie?
If it's everything you think it's going to be, based on what we said.
Because remember, you're listening to a once-in-a-lifetime voice performance from Paul McCartney, the whole movie. So it's, you know, a lot of buzz. A lot of Oscar buzz. Right.
I mean,
it's notoriously well-aged voice.
If the trailer's good, that's really what I'm waiting for. I'm a big trailer guy. If you can hook me with the trailer, I'm like, let's go see this movie.
Well, Cody, so, you and I, we've worked together on a trailer before. You know we can deliver, right?
Cody scored. I do know that.
Cody, for those who don't know, scored The Carrier, sizzle.
That's awesome.
An animated show that Zach Dixon and I pitched and are still working on and developing, but if you go look that up, thecarrier.tv, you'll see and hear Cody's amazing work there.
It will be made.
We can do a trailer, Cody.
I know you can. All right. I think that for my friends with kids, I would be like, hey, there's this great new movie. It's a Wild Wild West IP.
They're like, are you making money off of this movie, Cody?
And it's rated G, so you know there's not going to be any smoking or any other bad things that you don't want your kids to see. And so you should check out this.
It's the first thing I always ask. Sounds like, that's cool, Cody, but is there smoking? Tell me, is there smoking?
This sounds like a caption that's going to end with hashtag ad.
Yeah. A partnership.
Sentence. Cody ends his sentences with
well,
ad disclaimers.
Truly, I think there's probably just not enough family movies these days, at least from my perspective, because kids always want to watch movies. And there's like an unlimited amount of time that you could fill kids' lives with movies. And so I'm just like, any movie for kids, I will recommend to anyone with kids, because there's just, I mean, yeah. And, you know, this sounds reasonably compelling enough. I think the Secret Service, you had me at Secret Service University. That is really, I want to see a whole spinoff about like who came up with the name for that, how they did it.
Oh, so it was Frank Secret Service came up with that.
Frank Secret Service.
Named it after his family.
Named after it, right. Just like, what do you guys do at Secret Service University? Well, you know, we can't really talk about it, but.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, so what number would that be, Cody?
Okay, I'm gonna put a 7 on it.
Hey! Because...
hey, that's a passing score, baby. Okay,
yes.
My third question for you, Cody. Based on our assignment, which was a witty thriller for fans of the Beatles, set in the Old West, rated G, and not saying no in the pitch. How well did we adhere to that assignment? 1 to 10.
I mean, I don't think I heard a single no in the whole pitch.
Well, real quick though, Rene, speaking to our editor who can hear us, but we can't hear him. Rene, if you could, if it's possible, if Polly's paying you enough, could you tally up all the no's that we gave in this pitch? And real quick, just chime in with it right now and tell us how many no's there were in our pitch.
Hey, Rene here. So it looks like there weren't any no's in this pitch.
Wow, incredible.
Wow,
all right.
Love it. Thank you, Rene.
So based on that, Cody.
Rene seems great.
He's not real. No, he is. He actually is real. It's an insult to Rene. Sorry.
Yes. How well did we do? 1 to 10.
I think I'm gonna, you know, guys, I'm going to be real. This is not the best pitch I've ever heard. I think the phrase,
but is it,
there
but
will
did
be
it meet-
witty...
But was it a witty thriller for fans of the Beatles set in the Old West and rated G? That's the ultimate question.
Oh, man. Okay. See, I think there is a little bit of wit, like I mentioned, with Secret Service University. But then you kind of were just, it seemed a little lazy with the like, and then there will be some witty banter. That just feels like you got to do more than that, guys. I'm going to give the pitch a 4.
Wow.
That's okay. Perfectly fair.
That's fair.
I think you were coloring in the lines, but I'm still unsure of what the picture actually is.
No, I love it. I love it. Last question.
What's going on my tombstone?
Last question. This is 1 to 10. Rate the overall idea as presented by Ryan and Seth.
Oh, man. I'm,
full
honesty,
guys. No hard feelings.
I'm going to give this one a 2. I just am not, you know, it's hard for me to tell what this is going to be. I can tell that you have the rough outlines of some conflict, but I'm unsure what the cause of the conflict is. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, the dude is bad, but why? And also, who the hell is Jim West? I felt like mentioned him at the beginning, and then I'd never heard about him ever again.
That's
so
a
I'm unsure
question.
About. He fits in. Artemis.
Well, he's
is great
just so
name.
Busy working on his classwork.
Right. Okay.
For Secret Service University.
Lifting weights because he's a lug. That's his character to me. I heard that he was a lug. Don't really know anything else about him. To me, I'm still waiting for what is the conflict? What is driving the drama here? Sorry.
We love the feedback.
You got 2 points because you fulfilled the criteria, but I couldn't give you any more.
What's that score come
our
to,
total
Paul?
Is 18 out of 40, which is our now lowest score.
Oh, no.
Fully deserved.
fully,
fully deserved.
Like,
absolutely.
100% fair, Cody.
I'm sorry.
Ladies and gentlemen, Cody. Nice.
It's an honor.
Cody, where in the world can people find you besides all over their TikTok streams?
Oh, man. CodyFry.com. Yeah. Or just honestly, Spotify is probably the best way for me to make money off of you at this point. So just go there.
And if you're a Grammy voter, vote the living hell out of
all the Grammy voters that listen to our podcast. I would
love so many huge demographic.
Not allowed to solicit votes, so I can only say vote your conscience, my friends.
Vote your conscience, and my conscience tells me as not a Grammy voter to vote for Eleanor Rigby. And also, please go check out Cody's Eleanor Rigby cover. It's quite amazing and fantastic. I'm actually personally I love Eleanor Rigby. I love I Hear Symphony. I love all your work, pal. But I think my favorite thing you've ever done is your orchestral arrangement of Who Let the Dogs Out from TikTok, okay. Which I'm going to, with your permission, ask Rene to play for us, to play us out right now.
Absolute. Permission granted.
Perfect.
The Writer's Room Game Show with me, Ryan Pollock, and Seth Worley. Executive produced by Grant Wakefield at Weekend Video and Ann Fogerty at Plot Devices. Edited to perfection by Rene Gomez. Our art is by your buddy, Meg Lewis, and our face-melting music is by Ben Worley. The Writer's Room Game Show is a Weekend Video production in association with Plot Devices. Learn more about Weekend Video at weekend.video and check out writersroomgame.show to listen to all of our episodes and suggest your own prompts for future shows. And don't forget to rate and review our show on Apple Podcasts. It really helps our show out a lot. See you in the next one.